Hey, this is Hank Azaria. You're listening to Talking Simpsons on Laser Time. I didn't know that was a thing.
This week's Talking Simpsons is brought to you by Audible, and you listeners can go to audibletrial.com/lasertime and get started with a free 30-day trial and get a free audiobook.
I heartily endorse this event or product.
Ahoy, ahoy, everybody, and welcome to Talking Simpsons, guaranteed to be more entertaining than a box factory. I am your host, Bob Mackey, and I'm speaking up in case any of you are wearing towels. And this is the Laser Time Podcast Network's chronological exploration of The Simpsons. Who else is here with me, as always?
Henry Gilbert, and since this has nothing to do with boxes, I'll just shut these blinds.
And who else?
I didn't do it, dancer Chris Antista.
That's right. And today's episode is Bart Gets Famous.
Go for the face!
And this episode aired on February 3rd, 1994. And as always, Chris will tell us what happened on this mythical day in history.
Oh, my God!
My favorite character in Citizen Kane, Joseph Cotton, is dead. Mrs. Doubtfire...
You didn't do Oh Boy, Bobby.
Oh, my bad.
You're depriving the audience of the Oh Boy, Bobby they come to this podcast
Excuse
for.
Excuse me, let me reset. Oh boy, Bobby.
Wow. low energy.
Okay. Joseph Cotton is
dead!
My favoriteest Citizen Kane character. He's in love with cigars. Mrs. Doubtfire has turned the world on to transgendered hijinks. Lilith reunites with Frasier on the show of the same name. And AOL says computers are so overloaded that it must limit the number of customers during peak evening hours.
I couldn't hear you because you were shouting. What happened to Joseph Cotton? Is he dead?
He died.
Oh.
Yeah, well, those nurses kept him alive for a real long time.
They snuck him cigars and booze and
going,
stuff?
Wouldn't happen to have a cigar.
Please watch Shadow of a Doubt, my favorite Alfred Hitchcock movie. Joseph Cotton, I think it's 1945.
Ooh.
Beautiful, beautiful movie. Great, fantastic. I won't tell you what happens. It's great. He's in it. He's good.
Yes.
Just trust him on that. Mm-hmm. But this is quite an episode of The Simpsons. I think this is one of the most meta ones they have ever done.
It really is. And I was talking with you earlier, Henry. I feel like, we get a lot of new writers in this season, and they're really kind of making the most of ideas that were either squandered or not made the most of in earlier seasons. And I feel like this is them expanding upon the Monkey's Paw Halloween segment in which The Simpsons become famous.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it's more commentary about the state of the show, the state of Bart losing his place as the show's star, mm-hmm. and sort of the commentary on him being just a catchphrase.
I get the gags from that episode confused with being in this.
Yeah,
episode.
Yeah.
Well, you get gags about the Simpsons fame, but you also get jokes about
on a T-shirt.
Not in this episode.
But you also get jokes about the soullessness of television production.
That's
too.
True. David Merkin hates TV, and you see it all here.
And I think they also have an extra level of distance because, especially with Merkin running the show, almost none of the people on the writer side who were involved in the peak years of popularity are still there. So it's people from the outside who are on the outside looking into The Simpsons joking about the time it was most popular in seasons 1 and 2.
Yeah, I mean, they are now maybe number 34, number like 52 in the ratings. That still means 18 million viewers. I mean, more than any show would ever get now, times 5.
Yeah, without a football.
Exactly.
And this is an incredible episode.
It's beautiful. Directed by Susie Dieter. The first ever female director on The Simpsons, and she was Mark Kirkland's assistant director for a lot of episodes. Mm-hmm. He was sort of her mentor, but she is great. She would go on to do things like Futurama, but her stuff is always good. Her episodes are always really good.
I remember she's pretty funny on commentaries too, especially on the Critic crossover episode. John Lovitz, I was just like, John Lovitz, quit hitting on her.
Yeah.
I feel like, I don't know if she was actually, if I don't know.
Is
what
everybody
her,
watching me hit on this girl? Well, good.
I don't know which way she swings, but she joked with him of just saying, but what if I'm gay? I don't want to just say.
I think he might have just been making too many gay jokes.
Yeah, that might have been it. But yes, Susie Dieter, as Bill Oakley said in our interview, she was the lone woman on the director's staff back then that they worked with. And she's really good. Like, she has a very workmanlike quality, I'd say, and really good acting, I think.
And we see a twister mouth in this episode, which sort of caught me by surprise.
I forgot that Twister Mouth. Yes,
and I say this every time it happens. This could be the last one. I think we're getting to the last Twister
it
Mouth.
Might be.
Now I think we have to make a YouTube compilation.
I really want. I was thinking about it. At least a Frinkie Eye compilation.
Yeah, we can hide it because I only want to see them in slow motion. Yes. See how the nose gets over there.
How the jaw dislocates. So
and we never talk about the chalkboard gags, but I did want to mention this one. It's a reference to the one-armed man. Bart is saying that he won't blame something on the one-armed man. And that is a reference to The Fugitive, film of The Fugitive, the Harrison Ford, Tommy Lee Jones film. That came out in 93 and was getting Oscar buzz in early 1994 when this episode aired. So that's why
they got one for Tommy Lee Jones.
Tommy Lee Jones. Every outhouse, steakhouse, and pancake house.
House of Pies.
It's also one of those things that like everything you watched in this period referenced The Fugitive.
Yes. It did. It was huge.
And like unlike a lot of other popular movies from 1993, I don't ever see it anymore. I had to go out of my way to watch it again. It's still really fun.
I gotta watch it.
It's really good. And a movie based on a TV show that is really good and won Oscars. It's probably why they keep doing it.
Probably one of Tommy Lee Jones' most iconic roles of all time.
Yeah, I mean, he'd been in a lot of movies before then, but it made him famous, that one. And he pretty much would just play that character the rest of his life.
Because if you remember, he's in No Country for Old Men, and I forget that.
He's kind of the same guy, like the no-nonsense dude.
Yeah, the
he's
same guy, but like 4 years older. Yeah. 20
years
later.
They made this sequel without Harrison Ford, just U.S. Marshals, that it's...
Oh, you're right.
Fugitive again, except Wesley Snipes is the fugitive, and Joey Pants is in it too.
Interesting. I forgot, totally forgot about that. So this episode opens with Bart whistling an annoying but familiar tune.
This is fun.
Bart, I've asked you not to whistle that annoying tune.
Of all mine, Mamadunt. Why are you so happy?
Yeah, you kids got to go to school. I got to go to work. The only one who has it easy is Marge.
And then she's scrubbing the floor immediately to their right.
Yeah.
I feel like Bart humming the theme lets you know immediately this is a very meta episode.
This is
a commentary on the entire show with that theme.
And according to Simpsons Wikia, the show's theme had just been rated one of the most annoying by TV Guide.
Yes.
Like that same year.
They do mention that on the commentary, which I think is unfair.
Yeah. It's ridiculous. It's a very pleasant theme song.
And for plot purposes, though, for the entire first act, Bart is wearing his lucky red hat.
The last appearance of the lucky red hat?
I looked this up. So,
oh, boy.
He wore it last in Brother Can You Spare Two Dimes.
Season 3, again, they're pulling from season 3. They love it.
And it would not be seen again until 2000's Insane Clown Poppy.
Really? This is the last Lucky Red Hat appearance.
Until 2000, yeah.
And previously we saw it in Called the Simpsons.
Yes.
When they thought Bart was dead because they found his hat. So we see the same thing here.
When he washed it with a Homer shirt.
Yeah, it's most famous in Stark Raving Dad.
Yeah,
plot
that's right.
Device,
yeah.
That it turned Homer all of the clothes pink with his Lucky Red Hat.
It's so weird how that comes back so fucking conveniently.
Well, Mike Reese jokes about it that he said he heard newer writers joking like, oh, why don't we put Bart in his lucky red
What's
hat?
What's the origin of the hat? Yeah, I mean...
And then Mike Reese is like, guys, I'm right here. I made up that hat.
I'm now thinking of other references. Also, in Homer Alone, when they're bugging Marge in the morning, Bart asks where his hat is. It's behind the toilet.
It's behind the toilet.
Yes. We remember these things, people. That's why we're here.
That's why we're doing it.
And Lisa is having a fantasy.
I love this fantasy.
It's a really good sequence.
Impaled on my Nobel Peace
Prize.
That's
what ends.
How ironic.
Yo. Lise. Come back, Lise. Come back.
Why? I'm so much happier here.
It makes it just a cut above a normal flashback.
And that is the Nobel Peace Prize is a disc.
I don't have one. Time, ladies and gentlemen.
Not a pyramid. But I believe Obama was given one preemptively. Like, don't start wars. Have one of these.
They gave him an award for not... he became peaceful by not being George W.
That's
Bush.
True.
And whoever follows the current president I think they'll give him like two peace prizes.
But Lisa is writing her memoirs and is including many of her achievements, including having a Facts of Life reunion, including longtime holdout Tootie.
All right, let's get into this.
No! So you loved our 20 minutes on Hogan's Heroes. Set your faces to stun as we talk about the Facts of Life.
This is one of those shows I grew up around and don't know anything about.
Look, I barely watched the Facts of Life. In case you didn't know, Facts of Life was actually officially a Different Strokes spinoff.
Ugh.
And it was about a group of girls who live in a dormitory in an all-girls school. And you had Joe, Tootie, And two other ones.
I was kind of, I think that was one of my first TV crushes, the tomboy.
Joe the tomboy, yeah, yes. Yeah, yeah. And
think so of that what you will.
It was a very popular show, ran for about 8 years.
It's true.
And
one thing I remember, so I watched this a lot with my sister growing up, mm-hmm. and then much later, maybe 5 years later, watching Married with Children, they were never meaner to anything than Facts of Life.
Yes.
There were so many anti-Facts of Life jokes, and it was mostly about the girls being fat.
Yes. I don't know anything else about the show.
It was really mean to the, honestly, it's not fair of like,
no,
oh, you're young actresses, you're child actors who all go crazy and die,
yeah,
but let's make fun of your looks now.
And those, I mean, and the behind the scenes story is those girls were not treated well, the yeah. ones who were putting on weight.
Well, they're growing up on television, famous, yeah. well, going through puberty yeah. and have all this money, and like, that's a lot for a kid to manage,
yeah,
in addition to their weight and jokes about it.
Well, the poor Kim Melcher was like sent to fat camp.
Oh, you're
like,
right.
You're supposed to be the sexy one on this show. You shouldn't. You got to get skinnier. And that even Joan Rivers called them the fats of life on the Emmys
boy.
To their faces. But yes. that's what Joan Rivers
that's Joan,
did.
Baby.
Yeah, she roasted them.
They didn't realize how mean that was to poor children then. And now maybe it wasn't that fair, but so.
Over 200 episodes. Children. Wow.
So they did not have a reunion until 2001.
And future Lisa did it.
Well, Joe was the lone holdout of the original cast when they did the 2001.
I loved her.
But it was because she was, well, the producers were nice in saying she was busy with another show, which she was on a Lifetime show, but also at the time she was like, I don't want to be defined by Joan, I'm not going to play this character.
Fair enough.
And at first they were going to say Joan was dead, but and they were all going to her funeral, but then
like a kayfabe reunion.
But so instead they said no, Joe just couldn't make it, so her daughter came instead.
But it was a reunion done in the fiction of the Facts of Life.
It was a fictional reunion. It was a reunion special that aired on ABC and the Wonderful World of Disney in 2001.
Did George Clooney Looney, his wonderful mullet comeback?
No, it was only the four girls. It wasn't even one of the late the cousin Oliver of the show was not invited back.
Was like the head mother of that
yes,
place
she was
dead?
There. No,
Charlotte
she's
Ray.
Still around. Charlotte okay, Ray yeah. was still around then. She was still around 2011 when they did their last group reunion. That was not in a special.
I think
but
she was on Gilbert Gottfried's podcast. It was a really good episode too.
Oh,
but
the Facts of Life. That was really bad.
But the last interesting thing about the 2001 reunion movie mm-hmm. was that filming began on September 10th, 2001, and that they were filmed. So that was also why Joe couldn't even make it for one small scene because they couldn't fly to Canada to film it.
I can't imagine being on set like, oh, we're back. Nothing could go wrong. Oh, what's yes. happened? Oh, why, no.
I see no problem with watching the news. Yes.
I have the same feeling when I go, so this is a slight tangent, which I know you guys love, but when I look up screenshots or video games on this database we can access called Games Press, I think it is.
Yes.
I'll go to old games I'm doing research on and be like, oh, you uploaded these screenshots of Kingdom Hearts on September 10th. I bet you thought your little jokes were so funny.
And having worked on that side of things, that was probably in an Excel sheet for like 8 months.
Oh, yeah, like, yeah.
Wow, the campaign doesn't seem as important right now.
No, it's like an even bigger screenshot of Sora.
And so Kim Victoria Field, she played Tootie, who you may remember her from Fox's Livin' Single, which
yeah.
she was on at the same time this episode aired.
Wow, really?
She was quite the babe.
Mm-hmm.
Hubba hubba.
Hubba hubba.
So there, that wasn't too long on the Facts of Life.
Now play the entire theme song, and let's hear from Joe. We brought her in.
Theme song written by the late Alan Thicke. Mm-hmm. You gotta show, you gotta know it.
Look, enough of this boring ass Facts of Life shit. Let's start talking about something more exciting, like
Wait.
The tour of the Springfield Box Factory.
Preemptively, I have to say, this rivals the steam ham scenes as my favorite Simpsons
it's so good.
Thing, and it's even
I
longer.
Love it all.
The story of how two brothers and five other men parlayed a small business loan into a thriving paper goods concern is a long and interesting one. And here it is. It all began with the filing of Form 637/A, the application for a small business or farm. Many interesting and important things have been put into boxes over the years. Textiles, other boxes, even children's candy.
Do any of these boxes have candy in them?
Well,
will they ever?
No, we only make boxes to ship nails. Any other questions?
When will we be able to see a finished box, sir?
Oh, we don't assemble them here. That's done in Flint, Michigan.
Have any of your workers ever had their hands cut off by the machinery?
No.
And then the hands started crawling around and tried to strangle everybody?
No, that has never happened.
And he popped eyeballs.
Twist your mouth.
I'm not sure what kind of factory you're thinking of. We just make boxes here.
Sorry, Chris.
This
go
is one
ahead.
Of my favorite characters ever now.
I love the way this escalates in terms of boredom. Seymour Skinner is so happy. Everyone's like, oh, the box factory again. And he is just so tickled. He and Martin are really into this.
Yeah.
But as I said before on the show, I love boring characters because their jokes are the most specific and the most like laser focused. It's hard to make boring things funny, but it gets more and more boring as the scene goes on. I love the tour of his office too. It's like follow this line,
and in this
and
room,
it'll go right out the door.
Oh, they took that out.
It is like all the other.
My
ones.
Favorite thing in that is just the story of two brothers and five other men.
Five other men, and the voice he's doing is Bob Elliott, Chris Elliott's dad from Get a Life. That's his voice, in real life too. I mean. He was on he was part of a comedy duo called Bob and Ray, and Bob Elliott sounds like that. I think he just recently died. He was hanging in there in his late 90s, but that voice you could hear on Get a Life.
Oh, I love it so very much.
So I love that Bart is so excited for this field trip, and then it turns out to be the box factory, which is the worst. And then that Edna becomes one of the kids too. She's like, I hate this so much.
Not the box factory again, Seymour.
Not the box factory again.
And Otto, so we see like a foreshadowing of the Poochie episode. So Otto, on the way to the box factory, they drive by Toy Town, the fireworks testing range, and the slide factory. So there was no fireworks factory yet, but they're almost there.
Nowadays, kids will be thankful just to live in a town with one factory in it.
That's not in Flint, Michigan.
Yes, the shipping of unfinished, like they can't even finish boxes there.
It's like, it's not even a box factory. They just ship flattened boxes.
It is a fucking cardboard factory.
Yeah. Yes. And look, so kudos to Susie Dieter, but those boxes moving along a conveyor belt, I've never seen more fluid animation on The Simpsons in my life. Yeah. It's just so beautiful. Great. And perfect.
And I do like the joke about television rotting your brain to fantasy of just like, I'll just be like Lisa and escape into fantasy instead of going to the box factory. They were just that he can't imagine anything
the
because
box
of
factory.
Television.
It's so good.
And I loved his little TV. As a kid, I always dreamed of having a little TV.
It's the first piece of dated technology here.
I wanted so bad, but I could never get one because I think Sega made like 8 of them.
Oh,
was a TV tuner for your Game Gear.
You would need to buy stock in the Duracell company to power that thing, though.
The only thing I took from my considerably wealthy grandfather house when he died is he had a black and white Sony Watchman. It was like rear projection, like it projected a black and white image onto a piece of cloth through glass, and you could hold it in two hands. You had to do that, and I thought it was the coolest thing. And he died, and I took it, and like 2 years later, it's like, we're cutting out over-the-air transmission. So I still have it. It can't do anything.
Don't hold it near your crotch unless you want flipper babies.
It's the only thing... The only thing I can do with it...
There have been some flipper babies.
It is the only place... The only thing I own where I can get authentic static from. Because, like, static doesn't even exist.
I missed the actual TV static. Yep. You're right.
TV fuzz.
And another important note is that the building they're in for the box factory is modeled after the Klasky Chupo building.
Ah.
Which was just a rundown, shitty L.A. building. I'm sure that was, like a carpet factory at some place in the 30s or something.
Yeah. They love knocks on Klasky Chupo. They have so many... I think they say, again, the... Like the building that Sideshow Luke Perry flies through was also modeled after the Klasky Chupo building in Krusty Gets Canceled. And in his office that he has a calendar with boxes on it.
I forgot about that.
What I think is a paperweight shaped like a box, or it's just a little box on his...
No, it's just a box.
There's so many details, like his shitty windowless office that's just stark and depressing inside.
And they just have to walk through a line and... But then they reveal that the box factory is right next to the Channel 6.
That's right.
And, which is not Krusty Lou's studios exactly.
No,
which,
I mean, they're all over the place with, like, is Krusty bigger than Itchy and Scratchy? Is Krusty an international celebrity? Is it just a Springfield celebrity? I mean, they kind of rewrite it for whatever they need to be.
Yes. And then Bart's escape through the laundry basket was so great, too. That he's just one of those, like, merkiny... undercutting of expectations. The last thing I want to say about the boring stuff, though, is that though this episode is credited to John Swartzwelder while Oakley and Weinstein were writing all these other episodes, it feels so Oakley and Weinstein, the specificness of it.
I mean, they keep more Swartzwelder stuff than they do with other writers, but as Bill Oakley even told us, like maybe 33% of a script credited to a writer is that writer's actual jokes.
Mm-hmm. You know, I don't want to say it's definitely them, but it feels very much like the Oakley and Weinstein funny boringness.
I feel like there was a lot of mean opportunities for John Swartzwelder jokes that weren't met.
That's true, yeah. It could have been crazier, too. Yeah. I think he goes for crazier over being funny while being boring.
Well, when Homer shows up, Captain Wacky is in town. Yes. And I've said this a million times.
I'm giving this the line of the show, or one of them. I had listed.
That's the joke.
Just because Bart disappears from the factory, they can't find him, they have to call Marge, she runs into the shower, can't get to the phone in time, and of course that leads to the next scene, calling Homer at the power plant.
Just a minute, don't hang up! Hello? You'll have to speak up, I'm wearing a towel.
Just a great non sequitur. And have we seen the showers at the plant before this?
But okay. It's when they're when they're talking about watching the Dredrick Tatum fight in Homer's place.
But it's such a good joke, and it's even better that they acknowledge it for no reason with that.
Yeah, I'm wearing a towel.
Just because it's ridiculous enough of the hello, and he's wearing a towel, that's funny.
And also, but he's showering at work?
Yes. But then just to drive it home, Homer's naked at work and only wearing a towel, just so he says, I'm wearing a towel.
And how did he hear the phone? Even
I feel it's it sounds like something that joke was pitched and then a writer managed to top it, and it would be really cool if we put that in.
Yeah,
and they did.
So as a kid who dreamed of how they made television, Bart going to the TV station was amazing to me. Is this how they make television?
It's a very Pee Wee's Big Adventure version of TV, in which everything takes place in one building. There are just different sets. It's here's your Western set. Here's your space set.
If you don't remember Pee-wee's Big Adventure, they're shooting a Christmas film with Wayne from the Wonder Years, a Twisted Sister music video, and a fucking Godzilla movie without Toho's permission.
Yeah.
And Tarzan.
And Tarzan.
They're filming all that at the same time. And that's why I love that it was a child's idea of what a film... I love that in shows now where it's the back lot. I'm walking by a showgirl and then a guy in a toga.
And every time, despite not needing it for any movie made in the last 20 years, a camel. Yeah, a camel will walk by in the back lot.
I mean, we also have the return of the "I didn't feel like it" guy. He's like, wish I was dead.
Well, he's back. A little later.
Yeah.
But
it's in the first act.
So we get to see Bumblebee Man, and I think this is non-canonical. Bumblebee Man does not speak English.
We see his home life in 22 short films about Springfield, where he is a Mexican-American or wherever he lives. I guess he lives in Springfield.
And always wears a bumblebee suit.
Yeah.
But not here. He's on Studios. What's Channel 6?
Channel
Studios?
6, yeah.
Channel 6 Studios lot.
Ay, ay, ay! No me gusta!
I'm sorry. I'm really not comfortable with this, Ethan.
What's the matter, love?
It's just, it's the same old tired gags, isn't it? I mean, let's give the audience some credit.
How about a giant mousetrap?
I love it!
And we know from previous episodes he's from Channel Ocho, not Channel 6.
Channel Ocho, what the hell is that?
Not kidding, I'm not gonna lie.
Yeah, I don't appreciate that. And then the best use of Bart's lucky red hat ever leads to another line of the show.
A perfect dumb Homer moment that he puts this together in his head.
I would give this line of the show, but I repeat it all the time, but never with the specifics.
Mm-hmm. Do you feel like it's taking off of the Star Trek con thing?
Well, it's kind of con, but it's also damn you all to hell.
Yeah.
And blew it up.
And four scenes in the Wolverine movie. He yells no as the camera pans
Origins
up.
Wolverine, not to be specific.
First Wolverine movie.
I love this.
He might have fallen into one of these machines. Oh my god, that's his lucky red hat!
Not a box.
He's a box! My boy's a box! Damn you! A box!
I love the sinister music. Yeah. Also, just like Homer thinks if you fall in a box machine, you become a box.
Yes. And then Homer, the Dan's voice is stretching like, box!
Yeah.
Yes.
A box!
And the animation too, when he's shaking Skinner, he could have fallen into one of these machines, the way Skinner shakes on when he's pointing. It's really good.
Yeah, so good. But actually, Bart is on the studio set, wandering around.
Krusty is really bad in this episode.
But I love Krusty in this episode because, again, he's any entertainment figure the Simpsons need. So in this episode, he's not only an egotistical star, he's also a mogul manager type.
He's the most jaded person in the world, too.
But astounding amount of cynical business savvy. But I love the Danish lines.
Yeah. Oh, it's great.
Because Bart steals Kent Brockman's Danish.
Well, because Bart takes the last Danish, and then he needs to get a new one, so he takes Kent Brockman's.
Mm-hmm.
Heck. Now, where am I going to get a Danish?
Here's a Danish, Krusty.
Gimme. Now, that's Danish. Where'd you get it?
I stole it from Kent Brockman.
Great. He didn't touch it, did he?
No.
Good job, kid. What's your name?
I'm Bart Simpson. I saved you from jail. I reunited you with your estranged father.
I don't know.
I saved your career, man. Remember your comeback special?
Yeah, well, what have you done for me lately?
I got you that Danish.
And I'll never forget it.
So good.
Also, so good. When he steals the Danish from Kent, he goes, yoink, and Kent goes, yoink.
That was the most overt recognition of them, of the Simpsons loving the word yoink.
Yeah.
What's so gross about Kent? Like, what does Krusty know about Kent that he's like, ugh, I don't want to eat anything Kent Brockman touched?
There's so many different things you can infer about Kent Brockman. One, he's a coward.
Yeah.
He's an egotistical asshole. And then lightly that he is so unapproachably right-wing and temperamental on set. I love that. I love that part about him.
If he loses his Danish, he won't work.
Yeah, and he's like, he's yelled about not having his Danish, and this is him on air.
Yeah, I know I'm on, but I don't care. I don't read the news until I get my Danish. Go ahead, try to find a replacement.
A powerful tidal wave in Kuala Lumpur has killed 120 people.
Hey, Chihuahua! Whoa, whoa, whoa!
Did it tell you who replaced Kent Brockman? Did you get that last part?
I'm pretty sure it's Bumblebee guy.
I know I've taken that too, of the way Krusty goes, like those non-word answers.
I'm sure
like,
you have.
You've heard me do it. Like if you ask, like, so Henry, did you do that? I was like,
Henry, did you bring back my DVD?
Henry, you go into that party like,
that's the one. Yeah, that's exactly what happens.
So did we get to the part where Krusty throws Bart the towel?
His big clown hand?
I didn't think it worked well in audio because we just referenced that in a Laser Time episode about Super Bowl commercials.
I do have a link to it if you want to play.
It just doesn't play well in audio. There's no audio.
We should describe what the Mean Joe Green...
Well, okay, it's a Mean Joe Green Coke commercial where like... Makes me
feel good. I love the overtly sincere songs in these old commercials. That's the way it should be.
I'd like to see the whole world smiling with me. Coca-Cola has life. Have a Coke and drink.
Thanks, Mean Joe.
Smile. I forgot how much I love the song and that.
I mean, you would see parodies of this all over the place. I know Family Guy did one. I'm sure The Critic probably did one.
I wasn't alive to see this on television, but I've seen so many parodies, I instantly understand.
Yeah, you know, it was 1980 commercial during the Super Bowl, and it's one of the most memorable ones ever because it was used to... It is like kind of a heartwarming commercial that it did very well. They played it internationally, I found out, even though nobody outside of America knows American football and would even know Mean Joe Green, who is just a defensive tackle. Like he was famous, but he wasn't that famous.
Was he actually mean? I don't know.
Well, he was known for being a rough defensive tackle. If I get the position wrong, I'm sorry, sports people, but
they'll let us know.
I wouldn't have gone out on that one.
He was known for being a rough player, but this was in his last season. He played all the way through the 70s. This was one of his last seasons, if not his last, and it changed the perception of him as mean. They're like, oh, you're fun. And that's also why it's an effective commercial of this mean guy that the kid is afraid of, but wants to thank him. Then he's like, hey, this Coke made me special. And
because of this Coke, I care now.
And Joe Green is still alive, believe it or not, which is for an NFL player who got beaten to shit.
We still have like 6 days before this post, right?
Oh, boy. Well,
drives into oncoming traffic with his granddaughters in his car.
Well, he still is currently, and he actually... This year, for a special during the Super Bowl, around Super Bowl weekend, he reunited with the former child actor from the commercial.
And he's like 50 now, right?
Yes, yeah. And he also joked that... So for the shot, the kid gives Mean Joe Green his Coke, a full Coke. Mean Joe Green drinks it all on camera. And so he talks about in the filming of it, he's like, I drank a full Coke every take.
And oh, my God.
Speaking
of Rick and Morty.
He would think, he would go like, good job. And they're like, nope.
Hey, kid, catch.
And Kuala Lumpur, if you don't know, is the capital of Malaysia.
But the joke there is that Ken Brockman couldn't read the word.
He didn't recognize the word.
Kuala Lumpur.
And in the recent history, from my research, in the recent history, they have had floods in Kuala Lumpur, but no tidal waves in recent history that I could find online.
I also want to point out that Krusty not remembering Bart is a very Burns-like turn, because they have to say, okay, for this story to happen, Krusty can't know who Bart is or remember, because there's too much baggage attached. So Bart kind of goes through his history with Krusty, and Krusty's like, what have you done for me lately? So I like how they sort of address that immediately, because Krusty should know who Bart is.
He really should by this point.
I mean,
Krusty, in Father Like Clown, he needs to be reminded of Bart's existence, but once he is, he's like, okay, I remember that kid.
I mean, at least, okay, saved him from murder.
Mm-hmm. He saved Krusty from going to jail for shoplifting.
Shoplifting, right, not murder. Why did I think murder? Okay, sorry. And then we have the reunited with the father, and then we have the comeback special. At least those three. There have been more instances where they interacted.
Yeah.
Camp Krusty, where they hung out in Tijuana. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's just so many Krusty and Bart meetings.
And this joke will kind of be redone again, but in the Itchy and Scratchy episode with Chester J. Lampwick, where Krusty, they name all the things they did to help Krusty, and then Lester and Eliza reconnect him with his estranged wife, and they're like, what?
That's right.
I didn't even know about that. So I like that it's them recognizing the show has a long history already, but they just need, you're right, they need to reset. If for plot purposes, if Krusty knows who Bart is, then the episode doesn't work the same.
Yeah,
and I'm guessing Mrs. Pennycandy must have quit that week or was on vacation or something. She would have been his personal assistant.
We saw the last of her a long time ago, unfortunately.
She would reappear in a background scene,
I guess,
some years
with
later.
With no lines.
Yes.
So where are we now? I think
so. The start of the next act is a great intro of the act break of Homer arriving with the box, like, Marge, I have something I need to tell you.
I have some terrifying, bone-chilling news.
And Bart comes in to tell the family that he's been offered a job, and his reaction to Homer is kind of like my reaction to people when I go home.
I love it. Political talk starts.
But for now, I got a job in the show business. From now on, I'll be helping Krusty the Clown after school.
No, Bart, you're only 10.
I got a weekend job helping the poor, and I'm only 8.
That's not a job. It's a waste of time. What could poor people pay you? Nothing. What satisfaction you get from helping them? None. Who wants to help poor people anyway? Nobody.
So, anyway, can I take the job?
The cricket adds a lot.
The looks on the children's faces.
Yeah.
In this audio-only version, I never noticed those crickets before.
I mean, it's always there, but when his voice drops out, it pipes up a bit. You can hear it.
Just so you know, kids, you're not supposed to be like Homer.
Yes.
No.
Find yourself sounding like him.
So I swear I've heard on other commentaries, they've said that charity speech had been given unironically by John Swartzwelder before. that he'd said that about recycling too. They've said in the past that he said, actually, there's more rainforest now than ever. So
that does sound like John Swartzwelder.
John Swartzwelder sounds like a bit of a conservative troll of the... Actually, that was another thing Al Jean joked in a commentary, that John Swartzwelder, right after the election of Bill Clinton, said, soon enough they'll have him hanging from a tree.
Yeah, they're going to lynch Bill Clinton for some reason.
Actually, insured people get sick more than uninsured people.
But that's what we love about John Swartzwelder.
Indeed. He's like a cranky, fun guy.
And one of my favorite jokes, look, white dude, fine. I'll take that criticism. But I'm also Italian.
I will not apologize for being white, Chris.
I'm also Italian, and I never, ever get stereotyped in shows. And when I do, I am so fucking happy. And my friends use it as in-jokes to describe me. I've been called Pepe after this. I love it. I love this clip. What a wonderfully old stereotype.
I remember my first after-school job. I was in a band. Hello, everybody. I'm Archie Bell, and I'm also the Drells. We got a new song called Tighten Up, and this is the music you tighten up with.
Hey, what's the matter, you crazy kid? You're chasing away my business.
Buzz off, Giuseppe.
Go for the face.
I'm still pretty good at playing.
I think the Italian organ grinder joke is gone.
Yeah, I mean, this character would become Luigi, too.
Yes. Maybe in the 70s, organ grinders, you'd see some of them.
In the early 80s, Italians were made officially white people. I don't know who made the decision.
Homer is a one-man band.
Yes.
Which, if you don't know what that is, just Google it. You'll see it. When did that dry up? When that fad, I wonder.
So it does, 'cause to me, the flashback seems like it takes place like in the 1920s, but it, yeah. I don't know. Maybe this was happening in the 50s.
Well, Bulber was playing a contemporary song.
It was.
If that was Homer's first job when he was, say, 14, then we know that he was 18 in 1974, so that would make this 1970.
Everything he said here for years sounded like
gibberish. I thought
like
it was just words. Yeah,
Archie Bell and the Drells.
Archie Bell and the Drells is a band that made the song called The Tighten Up, and it's, goddammit, if it isn't one of the coolest songs ever made in the universe. And why don't we take a quick break and hear that song.
Let's do it.
Called The Tighten Up. This is the music we tighten up with. First, tighten up on the drum. Come on now, drummer. I want you to tighten it up for me now. Oh, yeah. Tighten up on that bass now. Tighten it up. Yeah. Now let that guitar fall in. Oh, yeah. Tighten up on the organ now. Yeah, you do the tighten up. Yeah, now. I said if you can do it now. Show will be tough. Now look here. Come on now. Now make it mellow.
The Simpsons will be right back.
I hope you guys are enjoying this showbiz-focused episode of The Simpsons. I know I did. I really, really like this episode. But you're gonna, in a little bit, you're gonna get to see basically season one of Conan O'Brien, and I thought that tied in well to today's sponsor, Audible, where you can go to audibletrial.com/lasertime and get a free audiobook and a free 30-day trial just for signing up, where you can listen to almost 200,000 titles, audiobooks, comedy albums, radio shows on your iPhone, Kindle, desktop, MP3 player, anywhere you are listening to this show right now. I could go out of my way to recommend a bunch of bestsellers I've never heard of, but one of the things I just found that was on there that I've always wanted to check out is Bill Carter's War for Late Night. Yes, it's the guy who wrote that book, The Late Shift, that had an HBO movie based off of it about Letterman and Leno fighting it out for The Tonight Show. This is a pseudo-sequel, as history would dictate, from the 2010 fiasco where Jay Leno ripped The Tonight Show back from Conan O'Brien and Letterman made fun of everybody. Bill Carter's book tells it all, and you can try it out for free just for trying Audible out for yourself. And how can you do that? Once again, that URL is audibletrial.com/lasertime, and you can give Audible a shot for 30 days and get a free audiobook like The War for Late Night. You like Laser Time shows? Then you might like Bonus Time, Laser Time's weekly bonus show exclusively on patreon.com/lasertime. Here's a taste of what you've been missing. I don't know if it's a good question of the week. The movie you saw the most times for no reason. That movie is My Blue Heaven.
Oh, I love that movie.
And it's weird. I love it, even though there is literally nothing in that movie to love.
I remember seeing it so many times on the rental shelf of my local video store and being like, well, I like Steve Martin. But he looks like a real tool on this cover, and like
he's a former mafia dude.
Sucks. Very specific former mafia dude.
Oh, he's supposed to be Henry Hill. It's allegedly Henry Hill.
It is a secret sequel to Goodfellas.
Yeah, the comedy story of Henry Hill after Goodfellas. Yes, sequel, you're right.
But before he became Hank Hill.
But without giving him any money.
Yeah, before he went to the what? Production program.
Getting out of the mafia and opening a propane
dealership.
Always
wanted to be a gangster.
They carried my mother's grocery home. You know why? It was out of respect.
I just said you ain't right. I didn't mean anything by it.
That made man ain't right.
Get the heck out of here, Tommy. Get Bonus Time, Laser Time's weekly, full-length, uncensored, and ad-free Patreon-exclusive podcast, as well as full-length movie commentaries, wrestling and cartoon video commentaries, the first season of Talking Simpson, and more at patreon.com/lasertime, starting at just $5. You'll help us live, and we'll do our best to help you never be bored again.
Be out of sight.
come on and tighten up. It's impressive how well Homer still plays Tighten Up while being attacked by
that
monkey.
How hard that song is to play? Half that song is like solos from other members of the band.
He's still playing three of his like six instruments.
Yeah, Homer should have stayed in that job. Like, that's a really good job for him. It's funny that after staring at Homer after the charity speech, they then also stare at him after he's like, a gig, son. The job is called a gig.
Yeah.
And they're just like, anyway.
There have been previous episodes in season 5 where Homer says something crazy and no one acknowledges it. They just move on.
Yeah.
So, or Marge just goes,
As somebody who is living a dream of theirs of being, say, going from a person who plays video games to writing about video games.
I wish I was dead.
I know the both sides of that feeling of just like the fresh-faced person who starts, who then is like, we're pretty lucky, aren't we? And then being on the other side of seeing the fresh-faced person who starts, who then says, we're pretty lucky, aren't we? And I like, I wish I was dead.
I am the Danish guy.
Yes. Yeah,
there's one big myth, and that's in the Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory. What happened to the boy who got everything he wanted? What? He lived happily ever after. No. That's actually never, ever, ever the case. And you know how I know that? Every biography I've ever seen.
That's true. Yes.
And even being able to do this for a living, which I love every single day, but the guy saw me beforehand. I was so dumb and punch drunk and tired. I could barely form words. I don't know how I'm getting this together.
So that message is, you will eventually hate this. And this is actually, I recognize this now. It's kind of an arc in many Simpsons episodes of, they usually start Act 2 getting the job they think they love, and then the following scenes are them falling out of love of it.
That's true, yeah.
And just, this is another of those.
My moral of life is that you can't be satisfied with something unless you have degrees, and that has to mean that eventually you'll be dissatisfied with satisfaction. Otherwise, you're not evolving or growing or changing. Okay. Why am I talking about this?
I also like Krusty. I love Krusty's reaction to his horrible toilet. Like, I don't know what I was thinking last night.
But right when Bart's getting disenfranchised with all of show business in this wonderful montage, Krusty stops him at the exit door.
Bart, I need to use you in a sketch.
You want me to be on the show?
It's just one line. Mel's supposed to say it, but he's dead.
Dead?
Or sick. I don't know. I forget. Anyway, all you gotta do is say, I am waiting for a bus. Then I hit you with pies for 5 minutes. Got that?
I'm waiting for a bus.
Makes me laugh. Let's go.
Yeah, Bart gave Sideshow Mel a cheese sandwich.
Yes.
And just having cheese in his mouth, his lactose intolerance is so violent. Just having cheese in his mouth gave him violent diarrhea.
Which he spits out. He didn't
Yeah, he didn't
swallow
even swallow it.
And
I want to yell at you some more.
Dan Castellaneta is screaming. There
you
is
little rapscallion!
He is so good in this episode. It's Krusty and Homer and Sideshow Mel. There's cheese in the sandwich. Also, the phone call. I see you have the clip of it. The Clue reference. This was the one as a kid I loved when he gets the call from Krusty in class.
Yes, yeah. That is really...
Okay, kids, open your books to page 60.
Yes, Krusty?
Bart, I need to get your fingerprints on a candlestick. Meet me in the conservatory, chop chop. Don't worry, everything's gonna be all right.
And this is 1994, so most of the joke is Bart has a cell phone now.
Yes.
And he uses it for Krusty. Yeah.
A boy pulling out a cell phone in class was a strange thing back then, that a 10-year-old would even have a cell phone. But I love that joke because you get a Clue reference in there, but it is a funny turn on just like, I felt like that joke had probably, even in 94, been done a million times of, the celebrity accidentally killed someone and is trying to cover it up. This is even pre-O.J. Simpson. And so to add the extra turn of its Clue instead of just him going like, I may have killed an escort or whatever. I like that joke a lot better. And then they even have a joke too about basically TV writers complaining how credits are on TV, which is pretty shitty.
And that was the first time their credits were fucked with. Now, I don't watch a lot of cable TV anymore. I haven't had cable in like a decade, but now they do this weird thing where it's like, The credits are shrunk down to the corner of the screen, and they start before the show actually ends.
Intro of the new show.
Yeah, and they're literally illegible. It should be illegal if you're in a writer's union to have your credits displayed like that.
I only remember that from Mr. Show, that there's an episode where they fuck with all the credits.
Yeah, they're like drawn on or whatever.
And the Writers Guild said, you can't fuck with the writer's credits.
Yeah.
You're not allowed to
do that.
That's
verboten.
You cannot even make a joke about it.
And on an HDTV, I could finally see Bart Simpson's name in there. It is one of my favorite ever Simpsons made-up names is Betty Symington.
Betty Symington. I love also we get a taste of Nelson's like bizarre morality. Yeah. So we have that's for wasting teachers' valuable time, and that's for taking credit for someone else's work.
I saw it coming from miles away, but I love Nelson does that and then walks away to reveal Homer's been watching the whole time.
Yeah, just like you just punched my son.
Yeah, it was a great reveal of Homer behind there. Oh, and then it's Bart signing the things at the Krusty
over there
event. Yeah. Like, I love you, Krusty, over there.
And the first appearance of Monstro Mart, which is really like Costco or Sam's Club. We'll see that in Homer and Apu next.
Oh yeah, that's in the very next episode.
That Krusty shows up to all these appearances, sits on a stool, and stares longingly while smoking a cigarette. And phone culture has ruined me to such an extent, like you can sit still.
Yeah,
yeah.
As a human being,
and enjoy cigarettes.
Oh my god!
And we have again Barney impersonating someone else. Before he was impersonating Krusty and Camp Krusty. Now he's Bart.
Oh wait, no, we didn't talk about how I didn't do it happen.
I haven't.
So Bart is put in the sketch to replace Mal. All he has to say is, "I'm waiting for a bus," and instead
he knocks over everything
and says what is probably at that point Bart's like 18th best catchphrase, but they make that the catchphrase.
I am waiting for a... I didn't do it.
I wanted to include that laughter just because having done so many of these and gotten so many of these clips that The Simpsons does reuse its audience laughter on occasion. But this is my second favorite crowd laughing sequence after the smug white people of the Garrison Keillor.
Oh yes, those are both great crowds.
It's a different crowd reaction laugh with an awesome audience shot.
And this is actually like a shortened form of a line he had in Moaning Lisa when he's playing the punch out game with Homer, where he said, "I didn't do it. There's no way they can prove anything." Yeah.
This is hears like a voice sample in the Deep Trouble song.
That's right.
I think of that more than the episode it was in.
Yeah, well, that's because it was a catch. The Simpsons kind of washed its hands with all the T-shirt catchphrase.
Well, Bart's phrases were like, "Don't have a cow, man. I'm Bart Simpson. Who the hell are you? I Carumba, underachiever and proud of it."
And Bartman. Bartman only existed in merchandise. He appeared once in Three Men in a Comic Book, but he was not a character in the show at all. He was in a video game, too, but it was just a fun merchandise idea.
Yeah. Well, because Batman was so big in 89.
Yeah, it was like, here's a popular thing with another popular thing. It was pre-Family Guy.
Featured in my Facebook photo as a genuine 1991 corkboard thing that I ruined for an anti-Trump rally. at me, bro.
I love that shot of Bart looking at the audience. You get the real feel of like,
so good.
A star is born.
Yeah,
like,
it really is.
But even for me as a dumb old school animation nerd, pre-computers, the lighting effect there. It's the kind of there's a lot of things that you won't see with computer animation, but whatever the effect is that they create light casting upon Bart is something you literally can't see again.
It takes extra work
because
they have to do a second pass or a second layer of animation or actually use a light and film that. Like, there's a lot going on. Whenever they have like a layer of shadows, there's
sometimes
an intentionality
like brighter or
that.
Darker paint to convey light. Just doesn't need to happen
anymore.
Same
with like when it was ink and paint and they had a sunset. It's like, that's a gradient that had to be airbrushed by somebody likely.
And all the skin tones change too with the sunset too.
Beautiful.
I just love the physicality of this artwork,
but I didn't do it catches on. It's sweeping the nation.
Though Krusty thinks it isn't going to be reaction. This is such a stilted arch
another
line.
Great
do not have
meta joke on how the scene was supposed to go.
Remind me never to let you on stage again, kid. Some people got it, some people don't, and you, my young friend, do not have. Hold on, I want to finish this thought outside.
It's that kid!
It's the I didn't do it guy!
He's mine! I own him! And all the subsidiary rights!
I feel like in modern times, the I didn't do it kid is someone who has a really popular tweet. And like, they didn't expect their tweet to be really popular. They had like 29 followers. And once they hit like 10,000 retweets, they're like, contact my agent to use this tweet in your news story. Or like, contact my agent to interview me about this tweet.
Or a Vine star.
Yeah. Kind of. Oh, the Vine stars are all dead. The Vine mansion burned down.
I'm an Asian from Unilad. We really loved you.
God, yeah. Actually, a Vine star now is like a dated reference.
Yeah, there you go.
I mean, read the expose on the Vine mansion on Vine Street. Full of Vine stars. They're all horrible.
But also the Vine stars like, we should be paid more for this, right? We shouldn't keep doing all this for free. And then Twitter's like, nah.
Vine House?
Vine House. So then Krusty starts squeezing it for all it's worth.
Why, this rickety ladder in front of this door is the perfect place for this priceless Ming vase. Eh? Eh?
I didn't do it.
Thank you. Thank you. And now, the I didn't do it dancers!
They're like in Living Color's Fly Girls, and I believe in Living Color was still on the air.
It was.
At this point.
It was at its peak.
So this is a dual. I think this is a real joke aimed at SNL and in Living Color and other sketch shows that just got by on a sketch that hit out of nowhere. Mm-hmm. They're like, okay, we're going to say that catchphrase every time from now on. We have the sketch now. We just have to change out who Fire Marshal Bill is talking to or who the church lady is talking to, but it is functionally the same sketch.
Let me show you something.
Yes.
I did like every Matt Foley sketch, though.
Oh, I loved it.
Like, what will he break through next?
What was the one with him like in spin class? Remember that one?
Yeah, I think that was one of the sad ones where he was like actually drugged out of his mind and should not have been on TV.
That is... episode hosted by Martin Lawrence and musical guest Crash Test Dummies.
If you want to go back in time for the best Matt Foley sketch, it's the one with Christina Applegate and David Spade.
I want to live in a van down by the river. Well, you'll have plenty of time to do
it's like,
it.
I love when he picks up David Spade and says, like, wrestle around, and then David Spade has to, like, grab his face like, I can't laugh.
They can't stop themselves from laughing at Chris Farley.
But Phil Hartman is just on. Like, he's like, no way, I'm not laughing. I'm Phil Hartman.
Great sketch created
stuff.
By Bob Odenkirk.
Yeah, Bob Kirk was the first. Matt Foley, not Dave Foley.
Which explains why Matt Foley is so angry. It's
and
like
Midwestern.
Yes, it's like, this guy's angry in a Bob Odenkirk way.
God damn it!
But
refined by Robert Smigel.
Yes, but through the lens of the fat Chicago-ness of Chris Farley.
Oh, beautiful, beautiful.
Read the Chris Farley Show. It's one of the best. It gives you a real history on that,
makes
too.
You want to go back in time and save him, too.
Oh,
I just had a depressing revelation that we've lived way longer without Chris Farley than I have with him.
Yeah. We all have.
And I just love that guy so much. But he had catchphrases, so did Bart, and Bart's a sweeping the nation. Mm-hmm. Even Apu is saying it.
Don't move, dude. This is totally a gun.
I didn't do it.
Reminds me of a more innocent time when a catchphrase hits and everybody can just say it. Yeah. And like, there's no judgment or by people like me. I'll admit it.
Also, so we have Quimby. Previously with the Gabo episode, he used the I'm a bad little boy to get out of the allegations that he killed his opponent, his political opponent. Now he uses another catchphrase.
And it worked on everybody, but we can assume maybe not his wife until now.
Honey.
Joe. How could you?
I didn't do it.
good Nancy laughter there. That is officially the first appearance of Mrs. Quimby.
And do we know his name was Joe before this? That's obviously
Joe
Diamond Kennedy.
Joe Quimby.
Oh, Diamond
they,
Joe Quimby, you're right.
That,
yeah.
Yeah, I think in his first appearance.
Sorry about that.
The best use of it is Patty and Selma.
I didn't do it.
This is the third time that this building has burned down because someone has been smoking in bed. I didn't do it.
The guy's I never heard the help me before, but the guy still stuck in the fire is cracking up.
I feel like they added that in after the fact because his mouth doesn't really move, but I feel like also at this time maybe it was dying out, but people dying from smoking in bed seemed pretty common around this era.
It happened.
More people were smoking, though.
He didn't die, but like my first friends like move out of their house, lost their house to falling asleep smoking.
Oof, man.
Yep, it turns out smoking, cigarettes plus what? Couches. Couches.
Mm. Couches
falls
are...
in between the two cushions, sets both on fire, slowly lights.
That's also your coffin.
And
yep.
So when I was a kid, I read at least a couple nice celebrity biographies. Mm-hmm. And so I totally could identify with this. Oh, this is a Bart biography, but it's not even about him. And just like, I know I read one on Hulk Hogan that I was like, this is fake. Like, this isn't Hulk Hogan's life.
Yet another crazy Homer line that no one acknowledges.
Yes.
Him being gay for Oliver North.
So weird.
He was just poured into that uniform.
The Oliver North trial was about the Iran-Contra affair.
He should be dying in jail.
Yes.
That's my political comment for this episode.
Yeah, if you're looking for any hope of rationality from the current political situation, didn't work before, probably won't work this time.
And speaking of SNL, that's actually one of my favorite William Shatner ones of the Mute Marine about Oliver North, who refused to say anything at the Oliver North trial. That was what I don't recall.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
That too, right?
Yes, that was when we got to see how knowledgeable Ronald Reagan was late in his
With all those holes in his brain.
Look, anyway.
Even more dated, a weird MC Hammer reference.
He's odd. No.
Love that line.
We have like two MC Hammer references in a row with the Homer the Vigilante and this. It's just like
this one.
Because Hammer wasn't not it's big Hammer. At all. Like it, even in his original, like horribly 90s parachute pants.
I think like
form.
Hammer Mania was officially dead in 92.
Was it?
I'm pretty sure
he was pretty close to be like the Hammer Man show had been canceled on ABC Kids in the morning.
This is how we do was coming.
Adam's Family.
Oh, you're right.
Adam's
this is how we do it. Is not
past,
Hammer.
No, don't stop the show.
We have to pray just all to right, make
but,
it today.
But anyway, the Hammer
Too Legit.
The Too Legit was his second one, his sophomore hit. But people had kind of been like, he's corny now, and he's not too far away from trying to rebrand himself as a tougher guy wearing Atlanta Falcons jersey
before going full preacher.
It's true. We are in the Bay Area. We can visit the abandoned Hammer Mansion.
Price no man can save.
Yeah. Overlooking Oakland
except
to
for
inspire
VH1's Behind the Music. The greatest
Behind the Music ever was that one.
Yeah.
But it is a weird Hammer joke because they're just listening to his music and it's not making fun of Hammer.
I think it's making fun of
The Yellow Album and Simpsons Sing the Blues. That's what I thought.
Yeah, it could be making fun of like Vanilla Ice and how you're like, you just took another song and just added your own thing to it, maybe.
Love the word proper because I loved Hammer. That's like my first CD I bought, Wayne's World soundtrack, second, Simpsons Sing the Blues, third, MC Hammer.
Wow. Please, Hammer, don't hurt him.
Don't hurt them.
I was a big, big fan. And just I never heard him say proper. I don't know what that's attributed to, but I love it.
He is the master of ceremonies, so he can say whatever he wants to.
And then right after that is when Barney is posing as Bart on the phone.
Oversaturation to the extreme.
I have to pay to see my own grandson. That's the Democrats for you.
See the boy, $5, or call him 24 hours a day on Bart Chat.
Bart Chat.
Are you Bart?
Here I am. I didn't do nothing.
Isn't it I didn't do it?
Yeah, whatever.
Wouldn't it be cheaper to just have a recording of Bart, like on the Lori Hartline?
Yeah.
That is how they did it with literally every other hotline.
I am so Crunchy the Clown.
It's basically the same joke as Crunchy the Clown.
I just love how they just hire this wino to fill these roles.
Everybody staring at Bart in the classroom is such a perfect way of doing fame, like of explaining fame, that it's just you're in class and you're trying to learn and everyone is staring at you. It's just the visual of everyone looking at Bart.
It's also my favorite ever Simpson shit post. Just of this. And then it pulls back and instead of Bart in the chair, it's Burns from the sitcom with his yes face. And yells yes and like, that's like my favorite line ever.
I never thought I'd say this, but shouldn't we be learning something?
Say the line, Bart!
I didn't do it.
Yeah!
That's probably one of the best images for this episode.
It is great.
Then we
have Homer commenting upon the phenomenon.
It's so...
Yeah. I mean, so we should mention Steve Urkel. He was the... he was a one-time character on Family Matters named after a friend of a writer on the show.
Oh, I didn't know.
And it ruined that guy's life, obviously.
Of course.
And the audience reacted to him so much that the show was eventually built around this one-time nerd that visited the show.
Family Matters was supposed to be a story of just a black middle-class family in America.
It was supposed to be a boring black sitcom.
That's what I love about Family Matters. Mm-hmm. So it starts off as... What about this middle-class black family and their struggles of everyday life? Mm-hmm. Season 8. What if there were potions and wizards and magic, and he could turn into a robot and Bruce Lee, and occasionally they get shrunken down and attacked by an evil puppet?
What then? Even with Urkel, it started out, he kind of loves Laura, but the school thinks he's a nerd. And on 302010, we just talked about the episode. Well, in the second to last season, Urkel invents time travel, and they go back to pirate times. That's what happens.
Like, the chemistry between Jaleel White and Reginald Bell Johnson is amazing. It's just like Mark Lynn Baker and Bronson Pinchot on Perfect Strangers. They are great together as these characters. Like, fuck everyone else in that entire show. Them together is like magic, even in the crappiest episodes.
If you grew up watching Family Matters, the show, the cast was huge, and every year, he just like a child fired... Yeah. So Jaleel White could get more money.
Yeah. And I mean, it eventually got
offered.
The Winslow
shrunk to three people.
Mm-hmm. Like, Jaleel White kind of experienced the Carrot Top effect, where he's like, I'm going to bulk up and no one will make fun of me anymore in real life. But yeah. Urkel on the show was also buff, and you could see his enormous package through his tight pants.
It is true, yeah. It, well,
voice,
also.
Voice of Sonic, never want to let that go.
I felt bad for Waldo that he was brought in. He was Eddie's friend Waldo. He's like, no, you're supposed to be the funny idiot. And they're like, nah, Steven's the funny one here.
Oh, Waldo Roldo Faldo.
Yes. Waldo Roldo Faldo. That Key and Peele sketch is so great about how Jaleel White / Urkel took over the show on the series and just ruined it or made it better.
And I believe Family Matters was savvy enough to make a joke where a character, over the credits, a character confuses Reginald Vell Johnson for James Avery, dad on Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, and he shows up on the show.
I remember that.
And I was like, this is amazing. Like, the two large black dads are finally appearing on the same show.
James Avery is about a foot taller than Reginald
Vell Johnson.
That's true,
but they're so huge and powerful.
Yes, also, I did hate about the Stephen Urkel character that he was, I'm wearing you down.
I'm wearing you down.
And he did wear her down. She marries him in the season series finale.
I totally missed that. But it's, what's wrong with liking cheese?
Yeah.
Cheese is great. I will die on this hill.
Anyway, why are we talking about Urkel?
This is why.
Come on, Lisa, say something funny.
Like what?
Oh, something stupid like Bart would say. Bucka bucka or wuzzle wuzzle. Something like that.
Forget it, Dad. If I ever become famous, I want it to be for something worthwhile, not because of some obnoxious fad.
Obnoxious fad?
Don't worry, son. You know, they said the same thing about Urkel. That little snot boy, I'd like to smack that kid.
Homer wants to just turn his violence onto Urkel.
How quickly it turns. He made this point.
Smack that kid. Like Urkel.
With those Urkelos.
Yeah.
But this is really great, and I'm glad this is the perfect kind of thing for us to talk about an hour into the episode. Bart gets to go on a talk show. What talk show?
Conan O'Brien. So, it's really funny because around the same time in the real world, there is a joke on The Critic where Jay goes to his favorite restaurant, but he is bumped from his table by Conan O'Brien. Yes. And the joke there is, nobody knows who Conan O'Brien is, and I'm sure the writers thought his show would have been canceled by that point in time.
Yes, everybody figured it would be canceled. In case you somehow don't know the history of Conan, the short version is that he was a writer on The Simpsons for seasons four and five.
Writer on SNL, got tired of that, got out of that contract to go work on The Simpsons, and Lorne Michaels was like, there's an opening after Letterman's leaving.
Would you like to host my late night show?
Well, they wanted many people to take it. They thought they could get Jerry Schilling or Billy Crystal. None of them wanted to work every night.
Conan is my Letterman.
Yeah.
He's my favorite talk show host. But it's a testament to how fucking powerful Lorne Michaels is.
Yeah.
He liked Conan. Nobody knew who he was.
I mean, and everybody was sure it would be over. And he constantly joked on the show of like, this has the worst ratings. No one watches it. I'm not popular.
I think they stopped talking about it after 7 years the show finally wasn't at the risk of cancellation. But he talks about the first 2 years, like it was week to week and exhausting. And Letterman even came back to NBC to be on the show because like, man, they're really going to fuck with this kid. I mean, I gotta help.
I started watching Conan when it started when I was like 11, and it blew my mind. It was like proto Mr. Show comedy. Mm-hmm. They would have like fake guests on, and they would do these amazing sketches where Conan would take his desk out onto the streets of New York, but it was all just a giant elaborate green screen bit.
Talk to a clutch cargo Bill Clinton.
Exactly. Just like so many like very formative things for me. So it always brings me back to that time recording these shows, seeing his original sets too.
And finding out that he was also involved in The Simpsons was like years later. I'm like, man, I was really right to love this guy.
Well, and they made his original set because they were animating it like right around when it premiered. And so they made his original set. And Conan's on the commentary and he even talks about like, God, that old set, that first set looks so. I love it though. It's a very sweaty set.
That Mr. Show, like, did you paint mold on purpose? Like, why does it look like
it
this?
It looks like a 70s rec room, but what Bart says feels like an ad. So he says he's going to be on the show, but he's like, just watch the Conan O'Brien show. You'll find out. I feel like that is like an on-the-nose ad.
You can actually have a clip of Bart saying, watch the Conan O'Brien
show. It's twice where they say late night with Conan O'Brien. They tell you the time slot, and they show you the logo.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you know nobody paid for it. It was just a nice favor they were doing for their buddy.
I do enjoy Homer's joke. After Leno, I'm all laughed out. acknowledging Jay Leno sucks in 1994.
But also two-fisting sandwiches while he says
acknowledging
it.
The time slot. I love that. And then that the concern was, if we make this joke, not only will people might not get it, but the show might not exist to get if we make it.
Conan jokes, it would have aired after he was canceled in the way that there were jokes about James Dean in movies after he died.
Famous speedster.
James Dean.
Oh, here's the clip. It's lovely.
What the hell are you reading books for?
I'm doing the Conan O'Brien show, and I want to have some intelligent stuff to talk about.
Don't forget to say I didn't do it.
Dad, there's more to me than just a catchphrase.
How do you figure, boy?
Watch the Conan O'Brien show. You'll see.
All right, but after Leno, I'm all left out, you know.
You know, Conan, I have a lot to say. I'm not just a one-line wonder. Did you know that a section of rainforest the size of Kansas is burned every single...
Just do the line.
I didn't do it.
Great material. We'll be right back. Sit perfectly still. Only I may dance.
I do love that.
I love the joke, but it gave me the faulty perception that Conan danced... out to break.
He doesn't and that's dance not on a break. No.
Isn't the thing that ever happened.
I haven't watched him regularly in like 15 years, but he did dance a lot during his monologues. He would do the string dance where he like cut the strings on his like the fake strings
like
on his body parts.
12 years in Conan.
Yeah. But he did like he was very animated. Yeah. I think like he was never afraid to make a fool of himself, which is why the show was so interesting.
The only reason the only way I can really describe what I loved about Conan that it was just like low budget cartoon starring real people.
Yeah.
That was mostly what the show
was. If a streaming network like Hulu, which NBC owns, could just put all of the old Conans on there, I would watch all of them and relive the 90s.
They struck a deal with a TBS show knowing that like if we don't do anything with them, there's no money to be made not doing anything with them and give like licensing them to the new shows. So remember that you used to have to like show stills on the TBS Conan O'Brien show.
That's right.
This is what we used to do. Find this on YouTube, but I think they started playing clips of the show.
I remember in the summer that Syphil and Ollie was on MTV, I would stay up to watch Syphil and Ollie and like, well, it's over. Conan's on. Let's give that a watch.
That was a good summer for me, too.
I remember the...
good summer of watching television.
Yes.
It
was like Space Ghost and Syphil and Ollie and
I was
also
so happy
Conan.
Comedy Central made a big deal out about it. They would rerun last night's Conan O'Brien at 7 p.m. the next day. And like,
that's right.
It was bliss for me. That was so short-lived, but I was so happy.
I mean, in the 90s, I watched the 80s David Letterman on E!
Yep.
And that's how I saw every Chris Elliott sketch and stuff like that. All the stuff I missed.
Stupid pet tricks. All the things
the Sonny and Cher reunion.
And all the Larry Bud Melman stuff.
Then Bart dreams of what his fame is going to be as a one-hit wonder, and he dreams of Match Game 2034.
Let's start a couple living people, too.
So there's Match Game 2034 honestly feels like the pilot for Futurama. Everyone is dressed like Futurama characters, and there is a head in a jar that is kept alive. That's Kitty Carlisle.
Still alive?
No, she died in 2007 in 1994.
Well, Farrah Fawcett.
At age of 95.
Definitely didn't make it to 2034.
She died in 2009. Mm-hmm. I can give you the ages of all people still alive on
day
this
after Michael Jackson and was totally like a day before
That's
Michael
right.
Jackson was totally overshadowed.
I think it was
overshadowed.
Even the same day. Like they made a special for her of like her last days in cancer. It was like, no, Michael Jackson.
Pull that
died,
Life
like,
magazine off the shelf. It's Michael
it's,
Jackson time.
Sucks to be you, I guess. But so here are all the people on the show in 2034. Here's how old they would be. Billy Crystal would be 86. One interesting thing is that
they predicted his beard. I just have to say
that's
that.
True. I mean,
he didn't have the beard then. He has it now.
It was a foregone conclusion. But Farrah Fawcett, Majors O'Neill, Varney. They predicted she would marry Jim Varney, aka Ernest.
I love that.
And he died in 2000. She died in 2009.
Whew.
Lonnie Anderson will be 88 in 2034.
Famous ventriloquist.
And Spike Lee will be 77. Damn. I think Lonnie Anderson transitioned into ventriloquy in her
I guess
old
that's
age.
A joke. Yes.
Yeah, instead of being like a blonde bombshell. But that's all the ages of the people. Spike Lee will probably live till that date, so we might see him on Match Game 2034.
So. Mm-hmm. And there is currently a Match Game show on NBC right now.
No.
And they had Kitty Carlisle there because she was a regular on the original Match Game in the 70s, and also most famously on To Tell the Truth.
Oh, you're right.
She was one of the constants on that. She was really a singer and stage performer by trade, who then on TV just became a TV personality from pretty much the birth of television.
I do love that. I don't know why, but let's start the game.
Well, Kitty Carlisle was, I think, the most famous movie to me she was in was A Night at the Opera, the Marx Brothers film.
She's in a Marx Brothers film.
Yes.
We are talking.
And this, she lived until 2007, 10 wow. years ago. So.
95, man. Wow. That's crazy.
So before the scene I, we love, there's one thing I want to point out. In the scene where people are walking on Krusty's back, David Silverman is in the background playing the tuba.
Oh, wow.
He plays the tuba in real life. His name on Twitter is Tubatron. Please follow Tubatron. He will retweet, like, ancient 30-year-old sketches he did for scenes you
I
know
love
and
that.
Love.
I love it. He's like, hey, I found this little drawing from the Butterfinger commercial. This Butterfinger commercial. Pretty crazy, huh?
I mean, David Silverman seems like the chillest dude. He goes to Burning Man every year, yes. has his own camp. Like, I know. He's living the dream, man.
It's amazing. I love that. Go, David Silverman. I mean, I'd love to talk with him someday. That would be great.
Hint, David.
But Marge, in I think the third time in this show, has another you're making people happy line.
Yeah.
Like, I am twice this... with Homer and this time with Bart.
But I'm this person as an entertainer now. I used to be worried about selling out, but every time I like hit on something, like,
listen,
yeah,
I've accepted if people want you to do something, do it. You're making them happy. Don't worry about if you're short selling yourself or whatever.
I'm Roger
like,
Rabbit.
Do what
my
you do
job
best.
Is to make people happy and laugh, and that is an entertainer's job. If they're attacking you for your politics, you're not doing your job well as an entertainer.
So where's Bonsoir? Let's hear Bonsoir.
Oh, yeah. I have to like look up another French word just to do that. Just to do that character. I think we should almost retabulate and make this line of the show because it's framed and delivered so well. I'm not going to play the sound effect, but I love it.
I know you feel a little silly saying the same four words over and over, but you shouldn't. You're making people happy, and that's a very hard thing to do.
You're right, Mom. I shouldn't let this bother me. I'm in television now. It's my job to be repetitive. My job. My job. Repetitiveness is my job. I am going to go out there tonight and give the best performance of my life.
The best performance of your life?
The best performance of my life.
That is so offensively great.
It's really good.
I love how much they rub it in. So Marge has given this speech twice before. Once in Blood Feud about how like Homer should be happy that he saved Mr. Burns' life. Yes. Another one in Flaming Moe's that you're making people happy.
That's right.
And in this one, it's the same thing. So Marge is really just like seeing the true value and just like being a good person with some like some kind of talent or some sort of giving quality.
So when they get to the show and Bart is ready to perform, Krusty's leap onto the spotlight is the most, it's so David Silverman-y.
I can't tell if it's Silverman or Brad Bird because Brad Bird gets like a Krusty scene now and then. The finger points, you know, like it might be Brad Bird. I don't know.
It felt more Silverman-y to me. He loves a finger pointing
up in the air.
He loves
moving around fingers. I'm going to say it's up in the air until we contact both of them.
I'm going, my bet's on Silverman. Bob's vote is for Brad Bird.
Hashtag Brad Bird, boys, if you agree with me.
It's a lot of alliteration happening right now. Spit everywhere.
And hashtag Silver is the man for me. I'm just stealing a Doughboys.
I was stealing from the Doughboys as well. Great podcast, by the way.
But, I'm very confused.
But nobody likes it when he finally does it because the spell is off. The fad is over.
Like the salivating dogs
If you had to examine it, Bart's not a great actor. And when he wasn't acting, it was funny. Mm. And then when he's trying, this happens to me all the time.
Oh, you know, I never thought of it
when
like
I try
that,
and do something funny, it has to happen by accident, organically. That's just the internet. When we work in a business, like, we're going to make this go viral. I'm like, you don't get to decide that.
Yeah, it's like, you throw it out there.
Something goes viral because it tends to do something unexpected or horribly humiliate someone.
You can't plan viral content
for the most part.
Yeah.
Executives love hearing that, too.
Oh, yeah.
You tell them it can't go viral.
Just make an incredibly popular thing. Yeah. So what's hard about that?
That's why we hired you.
I work at a website.
Another of my all-time favorite lines is the clown show has been put on hiatus for retooling.
Immediately, there's an announcer.
The live show, by the
retooling.
Way.
Ladies and gentlemen, the clown show.
Mine is just ancient showbiz terms. I love that.
What happened?
Oh, don't worry about that. You're just finished, that's all.
Finished?
That happens all the time. That's show business for you. One day, you're the most important guy who ever lived. The next day, you're some schmo working in a box factory. I heard that.
Boy, show business is kind of cruel, isn't it?
Oh. I heard that.
And then it just, the door has like no entry on it, just to make it clear. Like, you can't come back.
You're forbidden from show business. You've ruined your one chance.
It's over for you. And that when he looks at the guy at the box factory, I wondered if that was implying like this guy was he was an I didn't do it guy once too, and now he works at a box.
There is a little fiction there mm-hmm. that Krusty knows who that is.
Yeah,
it reminds me of Deep Cut, a Strangers with Candy episode where, like, in the town wherever Flatpoint is, you settle by working at the artificial plants.
Yeah,
and it's like the safest thing, but it's the most joyless, hateful job. But it's just there for you if you settle, and that's what reminds me of the Box Factory.
But he doesn't not want to fail.
Dreams are for fools.
Dreams are for fools.
The show rules, and we should have done that instead. We would have been done a year
talking
ago.
Strangers.
I mean, yeah, we've been done in under a year.
We just had to seal the name before Chris Hardwick did.
Yes.
Yeah, it's true. We had to get on it first.
But... You're not a nerd. You're buff. Get out of here.
So you have too many muscles to be a nerd. I disagree. And then they end with like another insanely meta moment.
Yeah, I don't remember getting all the... meta jokes in the show.
It just shows how established it was at this point, how it had such a strong identity. I love all the Bart merchandise. It sort of reminds me of the B Sharps merchandise, you know, all the Bart stuff.
So the Bart doll he holds in his hand is exactly a doll. Like, that existed.
Mm-hmm. The Burger King doll.
Yeah.
And Bender will eat his shorts in 1,000 years.
But I not only got this joke real hard, like, I am out of my seat. Oh my God, I can't believe they're acknowledging all this.
Well,
it made me realize that certain characters had catchphrases and I didn't know it. That even sound effects are catchphrases.
Well, and it's Simpsons recognizing they also use catchphrases. Mm-hmm. I think it's them saying, like, we're not better than catchphrases. We do it all the time.
Yes, I love this.
I saved these for you, Bart. You always have them to remind you of the time when you were the whole world's special little guy.
Thanks, Mom.
And now you can go back to just being you instead of a one-dimensional character with a silly catchphrase.
Hi, Caramba.
Idly ho.
Excellent.
If anyone wants me, I'll be in my room.
What kind of catchphrase is that?
So good.
I think they missed the poos. Thank you, come again.
Thank you, come again.
Yeah,
there could have been a few more, but with season one era merchandise, you can see them struggling to figure out things for Marge and Lisa.
Mm.
One of the ones I remember in like Spencer's Gifts or wherever I was seeing Simpsons shirt at the time, Lisa's catchphrase on merchandise was, a penny saved is a pony earned, which she would never say on the show.
No, but they had they're like, well, okay, what's it about Lisa? She likes ponies.
She likes ponies, I guess, and she's thrifty. Who knows? But with Marge, I remember this one t-shirt and like poster. It was her. God, what's the one where they go to Mr. Burns' place? No Disgrace Like Home.
Ah.
She's holding a Jell-O mold that looks like her hair. Jell-O mold. And she says, I made it myself. So I guess it's supposed to be gross or something. I forget what it is. But I mean, doesn't really translate well to written language.
Yeah, you can't put that on the... Well, same with Suck Suck.
It's Thwuck Thwuck.
Yes, Thwuck Thwuck.
It's like, this does remind me of them trying to... I mean, if you buy Lisa merchandise, what is even on it anymore?
I would bet it would be something about her being a vegetarian, I would think. Or jazz.
And in the arcade game, her catchphrase is embrace nothingness, which I love.
that
should have been the t-shirt catchphrase. Homer's is yellow.
Yellow. That was a great episode. I love that one.
It's A+, man.
It's savage on entertainment. It's just like, oh, it's a cutthroat business that will chew you up and spit you out, and no one will care.
Written by people in show business, so they're right. Yeah.
They know it better than anybody, and that Krusty is great in his cruelty. I love that. And
And I mean, we are so self-indulgent on this podcast, but I wish we could have played the entire like 2.5 minute Box Factory sequence of just like the announcement, the drive there, the tour around his desk. Everything is just like, again, it is just like perfect comedy, like steam ham scene.
It uses the family well. It uses a bunch of tertiary characters to make important points. It introduces a major new character in a lot of scenes. It was awesome.
It's so great.
To me, it's A+ perfect Simpsons.
So good. And this is a great episode. One of the best of the season, I think. And even if it is kind of up its own butt in terms of being a comment about itself and show business, I feel like it still tells a great story about Bart. And we will see him become famous again later in the show.
And it works on a small town scale. In other later episodes, they will literally send Bart to Hollywood and have the Hollywood experience. But this is in small town scale. So they could still keep it Springfieldian while still making it obviously about Hollywood and fame in general.
Awesome. So that was a great episode, everybody. Thank you for listening to Talking Simpsons. I've been your host, Bob Mackey. You can find me on Twitter as Bob Servo. I also write for the website Fandom about video games. Go to fandom.com to read my stuff there. And my other podcast is Retronauts. It's a classic gaming podcast every Monday at retronauts.com, or search for Retronauts in your podcast machine or iTunes or whatever. Every week is a new podcast about a new subject. Look up our Bart versus the Space Mutants episode if you want to get a taste of the Talking Simpsons crew on Retronauts. But if you have another
Simpsons episode coming up,
yeah, we're doing Bart's Nightmare soon, so look for that one too. If you're listening to this way after the fact, it already exists, so good for you. And if you don't care about old Simpsons games, look up any topic. We've probably done it. We've done like a 90-minute episode about it. Go to Retronauts.com or look for Retronauts in your podcast machine. Everybody else,
I'm HENEREYG on Twitter, and that's where you can follow me. I also want to say a big old shout out, well, to multiple people. First off, we ask people to give new reviews on iTunes. We had several very nice new ones, and I'd love to see some more on iTunes reviews. They really do help the show beyond other ways you can help it, which I'll get to in a second. But one person who really helps the show is Eric Nagel, our bestest buddy in the world. He, if you were shocked by the opening of this episode and the plug by Hank Azaria, that's all thanks to Eric Nagel. So I just want to thank you again of the It's Eric Show. On well, it's a podcast now too, not just on Sirius XM.
Sirius XM.
Yeah. So, and of course, this podcast is supported by patreon.com/lasertime, and it's where the entire first season of Talking Simpsons lives, as well as our seasons 2, 3, and 4 wrap-ups. Give those a listen, folks.
Yeah, thank you so much. And Lasertime, lasertimepodcast.com, it was the show that sort of kickstarted some of this stuff. We have a Patreon, patreon.com/lasertime. You made Talking Simpsons a reality, so those are the people who get season one. At the cost of just $5 a month, you can access 13 exclusive Talking Simpsons episodes, as well as three exclusive Talking Simpsons season wrap-ups. We talk about what happened in between seasons and stuff that won Emmys, the highest rated stuff, and some really weird minutia.
Commercials.
I'm out of words.
Yeah, all kinds of stuff. So thank you so much for listening. We'll be back next week with Homer and Apu. See you then.
Infotainment.